Today's agenda includes welcome and introductions, project overview, existing condition findings, activity one, SWOT analysis to identify strengths and weaknesses, activity two, visioning and goals. Questions and next steps will be following that. But before we get started, let's do a quick icebreaker pose. By selecting the chat icon in the toolbar, type in your answers to the following question. What is your role in the Edmonston community? Are you one, a resident of Edmonston? Are you two, employee of Edmonston? Are you three, both, four, neither, or other? Please type your responses in the chat. Okay, we got neither and other. Do we have more? Local business. Edmonston residents. Okay, do we have more? Edmonston residents, okay. Sounds good. Can we have any more before we move on? Okay, that's all I can see in the chat. If anybody sees any others in the chat, please let me know or we'll move on. Okay, in three words, describe Edmonston. How do you feel about this in three words? Okay, someone help me with the chat. I'm trying to see what the responses is. And right now I don't see anything in the chat. If someone sees something in the chat, let me know. Quiet neighborhood, okay. Quiet neighborhood, oh, quiet neighborhood again. Okay, do we have any more in the chat? Okay, let's see, that's all that we have. This is great feedback. Thank you very much. Now we will move on so I can introduce the team. Now I would like to introduce the team. From the consultant team, we have Richard Clinch, Project Director, Jacob Francis Institute. I'm sorry, because when you always come to these names, Anyas Otomi, Project Planner, Otomo and Associates. And I always mess up with these names. I do apologize for that. And from Prince George's County, again, my name is Samuel White. I'm the Project Manager. Zachary Luckins, he's Deputy Project Manager. From the Prince George's Planning Department, we have Karen Miro, we have Daniel Sams, and we have Max Van Allen. From Otomo and Associates, we have Edith Kellier and Maria Pantelios. Next slide. This economic development strategy was applied by the town of Edmonston, the planning department, planning assistance in municipalities and community program, known as PMAC. The strategy would help the community develop an economic vision and goals, identify funding and collaboration opportunity, leverage resources from various entities to meet the plan objective. The areas of focus are as follows: business retention, improving the business climate, and industrial preservation, economic diversity, recommendation for the needed community improvements and investment. The economic development strategy does have some limitations. The strategy cannot, for example, change tax levies, bringing significant business to Edmonston, recommend zoning changes, and regulate future development. Currently, the project timeline is shown here. It is slated to approximately 1 year to complete. It was initiated in August of 2021 and is scheduled to conclude in August of 2022. A final community meeting will present the draft economic development strategy and will be held in late spring and early summer. Now I would like to turn it over to our consultant team to present information about the economic development and existing conditions analysis. Richard, I would like to turn it over to you.
Thanks, Sam. Thanks for that great introduction of the project. I'm Richard Clinch. I'm the project lead on this for the consulting team. I'm going to begin by going over kind of an overview of what an economic development strategy is. So according to the National League of Cities, economic development is the process of building strong and adaptive communities. Each municipality's economic development goals are different, but the core goals for economic development are for the town of Edmonston to enhance its business and employment base by assessing the town's assets and economic role and aligning these assets to give the ideas and strategies to the town's leadership through the discussions we're having tonight. I'm now going to go over some of the preliminary findings we've had in terms of our assessment of the town's overall economic development strengths and weaknesses. What we first looked at was the town of Edmonston's population. What we found is that the town is just over 1,400 residents and has a high concentration of those identifying as Hispanic or Latino. The population in the town is growing more slowly than the county and neighboring jurisdictions. Town residents have median incomes lower than the county average, with a high concentration of town residents having less than a college education, and many are employed in skilled trades such as construction or production jobs. The second thing we really looked at was the town's economy. So looking at the town's economy, we found that the town is a real employment center in its own right. It has a large number of jobs per residence. So there are about 1,500 jobs in the town's 124 businesses. Unemployment grew by 9%, slightly lower than the county, between 2013 and 2019. The town's employment base is concentrated in industrial sectors like construction, manufacturing, and the town has a relatively small base of retail and traditional office jobs. The town's employment base is highly concentrated in blue-collar jobs, with a high concentration of those jobs paying more than $3,333 a month, which is the highest tracked by this data source. So while it has a lot of middle-skilled jobs, these also have relatively high pay scales, which is good. The next thing we looked at is the town's real estate assets, both at the residential side and the commercial side. So in terms of real estate, the town's housing stock, when you're looking at the housing side, is older, mostly owner-occupied, and has a low vacancy rate and lower cost than the county and neighboring jurisdictions. In the area of commercial real estate, which is most important for economic development, the town has a large amount of industrial space, which we'll describe later. This space is in very high demand in the county and the region, since it's in competitive in cost and has a very low level of vacancy. As I mentioned before, the town has only a limited amount of retail and office space. The town's commercial areas are largely full and occupied, and there's been limited new development in the recent past. I will now hand the presentation over to Agnes, who will review our community assessment of the town of Edmonston.
Thank you, Richard. We're now going to look at some of the factors that are in the background but affect our ability to do changes through economic development. First, we'll take a look at the zoning in the area. Zoning plays an important role in economic development as it regulates the types of uses and buildings that can occupy any given property. With the new approved Prince George's County zoning ordinance, there are several notable changes in Edmonston that we'd like to highlight. First, taking a look at the Northern Industrial Park, highlighted by the dotted lines on the map. at Lafayette Place and Ingram Street. Zoning was changed from light industrial I-1 to neighborhood activity center NAC. The NAC zone allows for lower density, small scale, mixed use centers intended to serve surrounding neighborhoods. Vertical mixed use development, which means a multi-story building with different uses in it, is anticipated with ground floor retail, service or office uses on the ground floor and residential above, and that is being encouraged by this new zone. Doesn't mean it's going to happen, but it sets the stage for changes in that area. Next, we'll move to the east side of Kenilworth Avenue, the area that's basically red on the map surrounded by those black dotted lines. The zoning was changed from mixed-use transportation, MXT, to commercial service, CS. CS allows for higher intensity and auto-oriented commercial uses, complemented by other retail sales, service uses, and medium-density multifamily, artist studios, and live-work development. So a little bit of a mix of the kinds of things that can happen there. And then finally, the third zone that changed is in the gray area to the left of the map, at 46th and Decatur Street, changed from mixed-use transportation, MXT, to industrial employment, IE. The IE zone allows for a mix of light industrial, employment, and research and development uses with an expectation of high-quality design set apart from traffic-generating commercial locations and residential neighborhoods. The IE zone also requires 25% green area. Just to talk generally, zoning is not controlled by the town. This is part of the Prince George's County Zoning Ordinance. However, these changes have the potential to significantly improve and transform areas in the town. Next, we'll take a look at land use and barriers. Starting with a land use map, you'll see that industrial uses shown in gray are concentrated on the southern and northwestern edges of town. Retail uses, generally shown in red, are concentrated along Kenilworth Avenue. There's a notable absence of retail within the town borders. Residential uses predominate north and south of Decatur Street, but also east and west of the river. Open space abounds along the Anacostia River, yet it also divides the town. There are really two distinct neighborhoods. There's also little office space and almost no other commercial uses, including hotels or community centers or schools at the current time. Overlaid on this land use map is a map of our consulting team's assessment of barriers and challenges. To us, one of the major challenges is the presence of the railroad tracks on the western edge of town. There's really only one connection point at Decatur Street, and otherwise the railroad is a barrier so that you can't easily cross into the communities to the west. The Southern Industrial Park is really an extension of a lot of industrial uses that are in Bladensburg, and then there's so much of this industrial that it's hard to see it changing. The floodplain, as mentioned earlier, divides the town, although it provides green space as an amenity, but still it does separate the two halves of the town. Most retail is outside the town, and what would normally be your main street, Decatur Street, is primarily residential rather than retail. There's very little publicly owned land that could be repurposed. And then finally, a barrier that's not physical, but more mental and emotional maybe, is that the town has a Hyattsville mailing address courtesy of the United States Postal Service. But that makes it harder to develop an identity for Edmonston because it always gets labeled as Hyattsville rather than Edmonston. We also took a look at what infrastructure exists in the community that could be a good basis for economic development. We find that this part of Prince George's County has excellent public transportation. There are some major bus routes. There's several metro lines. There's a future purple line. All of these things are great, although they mostly bypass Edmonston. I mean, they're nearby, but not in the town itself. The future purple line may be the closest major public transportation resource, and theoretically through the River Trail and other ways, or Kenilworth Avenue would be accessible to town residents. The town has ample parks thanks to this riverbanks, which gives a lot of open space and breathable air, and you know, from an environmental standpoint is really good, but it's also a dividing line. What we did find that the town lacks is community and civic spaces other than those park outdoor spaces, places where people can gather and meet each other or attend meetings or have special events, places that are normally schools or libraries or community centers in other communities. So there are a lot of great assets, but there's a few things missing in our view, but we'd like to hear more from you as we go further into this meeting. So this is a lot of material. You might have some questions, so we're going to pause briefly and Zach will field any questions from the audience.
Yeah, thank you, Agnes. So before we get into our activities for today, the visioning, we just want to know if you've got any questions on this point, whether that's through the community assessment or through our research findings. We'd be happy to answer any of that. And then also anything we don't get to today, questions, comments, we're going to post everything online after the meeting with answers. So don't, you know, feel pressure to come up with questions right now. You continue to engage with us after this meeting. So let's see, looking at the chat, I don't see any questions right now. Looks like I got one coming in. Okay. And we will have a question portion at the end too. Why doesn't the bus come through town? That's a good question. So there's two bus services that I know of. I know the route comes along Kenilworth, but yes, having increased transit, better accessibility within the town, I mean, that's an important part of economic development. You know, how do you have, you know, people come to your businesses if you don't have public transit stops? So again, we see stops on Decatur would be great. I agree. So maybe when we get to our visioning, we're going to be talking about, you know, supporting features of economic development. So that'd be a good place to highlight that. And again, maybe that's something the town could explore in terms of future options for economic development within the town. So unless we have any other questions right now, looks like we don't. So I think we can move on. Again, we will have one more question and answer period at the end after our activities.
Hey, Zach, I think I see one that stop on Decatur would be great. Just a statement.
Yep, I was just talking about that one. So that's some great feedback, and we'll make sure that gets incorporated as well. Some, you know, enhanced wayfinding and signage and mobility within the town are all great factors and contributing elements of economic development. So thank you. All right, so let's see if we can move on here. So now we're gonna do our overview of our two activities for this evening. So shortly we'll be going into our visioning activities where we'll have that more focused and facilitated discussion to get more of your feedback. So the first is we're going to do a SWOT analysis where we'll poll you to identify the town's strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And again, SWOT, S-W-O-T, is the capital letter, the first letter of each of those words. It's a SWOT analysis. And then second, we're going to have a vision board. So this is an interactive tool where community members such as yourselves can provide comment on several vision statements. What do you like? What don't you like? What would you change? And then we're going to do some goal setting for economic development through specific topic areas. And just a reminder, as we said before, the SWOT analysis survey and the vision board will be made available online for a period of 2 weeks following this meeting for continued feedback. Again, if there's something that you don't remember during the meeting, again, please tell your friends. You can go on our website and continue to engage that way. And again, those links will be provided at the end for those who weren't able to make it. So please spread the word. So with that, I'll hand it over to Agnes, and we're going to start with our first activity, the SWOT analysis.
All right. Thanks, Zach. Well, this is the fun part of the meeting where everybody gets to give their ideas and their opinions. So what's happened so far is that the consultants have done some research and we've come up with some initial ideas. But tonight we really want to hear from you. And so we're giving you some clues to what we found, but those should not govern what you think. We really want to know what you as residents and businesses in the town really think. So our first area is, what are the strengths of Edmonston? Strengths are defined as internal things that a community excels at and what separates it from other areas. So we'll be using the chat again to gather your comments. So please remember how to open up the chat and to put your comments in there. Our preliminary research found quite a few strengths in the town. For example, we found the town is fiscally sound. It has a good commercial and industrial property base. It has a large number of jobs per resident. The jobs are pretty good ones, middle skill, middle pay. There's several large employers. There's some really cool businesses like Community Forklift or the Eco City Farm, and it has been designated as a sustainable community. We'd like to know if these areas resonate with you or if there's others that we haven't thought about. So, you know, please let us know in the chat, what are Edmonston's strengths? Multiple answers are welcome.
Yeah, it looks like we got our first one that came through here, Anya. The river and the walking path connected to a large network of trails. And yeah, I would say that we've heard that a lot already, that that's a fantastic asset for the community, the Anacostia, a lot of history there. And I think, you know, some real opportunity for economic development. Riverfront is a prized asset in many places. So if we can continue to leverage that, I think that'd be great.
I see a comment about the Hydesville Arts District, which is interesting to me because I'm always puzzled by this problem with crossing the railroad. So I'd love to hear more about how interesting is Hydesville to residents of Edmonston, and do you feel like you can't really get there, or is it okay?
Yeah, and that's what they call the Gateway Arts District. So that's, you know, fantastic economic development they've done, is really branding themselves as a home for the arts, and Edmonston being that close to it, you know, great accessibility and kind of working and collaborating, leveraging, again, that identity could be great for Edmonston. I see someone said inside the Beltway. Again, think walkability. What makes a great neighborhood? Being inside the Beltway, there's fantastic amenities, great historic walkable neighborhoods. So yeah, that's another wonderful thing about Edmonston.
I see another trails and green spaces. So that's definitely keeps coming back as a theme.
We have another comment, relatively affordable housing. We also have, can walk to Hydesville in less than 10 minutes. It's the most unpleasant walk you can imagine.
That's a problem.
Yeah, that is a problem. It's trying to, there's like that little overpass, you got to get over the railroad tracks to get over there. So less than ideal. So again, that's a tough one. I mean, economic development can only do so much, and those are initiatives that have to be undertaken through public works and county government. But again, what really helps us is we kind of need to fuel that. We need the evidence, the community feedback to show that's what you really want. We've heard it already. We're hearing it again. So we can try to make a recommendation around that, and enhanced connections not only helps Edmonston, but certainly helps Hydesville as well. So it's kind of that give and take relationship. I see they've got a newish playground on 47th. That's fantastic. I know you've got a great town administrator that's been really, you know, doing his best to bring new amenities to Edmonston. And so continuing to do that, you know, is something that we can certainly focus on. And having amenities for the residents, that's great. It's not always about new businesses and new people, but it's also about supporting those who already live there.
I remember doing the walking tour. I think we went past that when we did a walking tour of the area in August. I think we saw that.
Mm-hmm. Great. Any other comments before we move on to weaknesses, which is not as much fun, but we usually get a lot of responses on the weaknesses section, so I'm eager to hear what you have to say. Looks like we can move on. All right. So weaknesses are also internal things, and they stop a community from performing at its optimal level and are problems that need to be improved. We'll use the chat again, as we have been. Our preliminary findings are a lack of something that can be easily identified as a town center, which has nothing to do with tall buildings. It just means like the heart of the community. Where do people see the town center being? There's very little vacant land that can be repurposed. Edmonston's pretty much fully developed. There's a lack of retail space, distance from mass transit, which we touched on earlier. The town's budget, of course, is small because it's a small town and residents can only be taxed so much. So there's not that much money to work with. And a lot of grandfathered industrial uses conflict with potential visions for the future because industrial space is very desirable in our metropolitan area right now. A lot of it has been kicked out of other communities. And so where it's left, everybody wants to rent that space, which is shown by your low vacancy rates. So it's actually a resource, even though you may not see it that way. So enough from me. I'd really like to hear from you at this point.
Yeah, so we've got the first one that's just come through the chat there, that the industrial businesses are more and more intrusive. There's noise, you know, light and pollution and garbage. It is, you know, relatively unpleasant, and there's that conflict between the businesses and the residential areas. This was actually one of the main inspirations, if you will, for the project. You know, we've heard this time and again, not only from residents, but from the town administrator. And so we are, you know, really taking a focused effort on what can we do to improve these transitions. As Anis can probably speak to, you know, the economics might say that these businesses aren't going to go anywhere anytime soon. And if that's the case, you know, we can't tell them that they can go, they should go anywhere. And it doesn't even mean they should. And what we really should be looking at is the transition itself. Can we create, you know, better buffering between these areas? Can we do some collaboration between business owners? I know cars in the street has been an issue. So if we can find a better place to park cars, have a little more communication between business owners and residents, I think there's some kind of creative ways that we can amend some of these issues without simply, you know, thinking of displacement as an option, because we don't really want to go there.
There's another comment about lack of retail in town. That's something that we've also discussed internally. I think one issue is that there's not really a retail zone that can be used for retail, which makes things a little tricky at the moment, but maybe it would be something to be taken into consideration at the next rezoning.
Yeah, and that's a good one. I mean, we think about the new opportunities from the zoning. And, you know, multiple areas we can have new types and new uses of businesses. And that'd be great, you know, as we look to that transition of some of the industrial areas. We have the IE, the industrial employment zone. It's not just your typical industrial uses, but it's, you know, small scale businesses, you know, manufacturing, supporting entrepreneurship. So we can really be creative with what we can envision for that area and supporting existing and new businesses.
I think the NAC zone at the north could also accommodate some retail.
Yeah, exactly. And of course, certainly along Kenilworth too. Looks like we've got something coming from Rosa. Yeah, the lack of retail, lack of sidewalks, no pedestrian walkway, pedestrian bridge or walkway over the train tracks. Again, that's a huge one. You know, these barriers that have been created, you know, are some of the biggest challenges we have to overcome. Certainly going to be looking into that. Updating business facades would be great. I know that there's a couple facade improvement programs in the county. I think even our town administrator has used a couple of those previously, and we can continue to do that. Certainly when looking at, you know, what is the physical environment that we have in our commercial and retail industrial spaces, you know, really has a big effect on, do people want to spend time there? Do they want to spend their money there? And then it looks like the last part of that is, businesses provide good opportunity to minority and small businesses, but agree that some can be an eyesore and be improved. Again, we have a very diverse community and the businesses reflect that. They can always be improved. And, you know, what better way through collaboration? I think that's our real key to success here.
There's another comment about the arts district to cater to more creative businesses and studios rather than industrial. Yeah, there's also the you know, the idea of repurposing some of the industrial space if there are vacancies, to move them into some other kinds of, you know, maybe maker space or kind of more innovative or creative types of spaces. So that's a good point.
Yeah, and I think that also comes back to a marketing piece is, you know, if you've got a, you know, a 15 by 20 workshop, that could be a whole host of things. But if we start marketing it as this is for, you know, small artists or some sort of activity, some a training center, it's really about how we frame these spaces. So a lot of the times we already have the built environment, but how can we market it? How can we brand ourselves as a place so that as we evolve into the future, we can see some new uses coming and new amenities for people. So that's a big asset, I think, for us as well. Mm-hmm.
That's terrific. This was a great discussion. If I don't see any more comments, we'll move on to opportunities for Edmonston. Great. So we were talking about internal factors before. Now we're moving on to some external factors. Opportunities refer to favorable external factors that could give a community a competitive advantage. It's something that could be done to improve a community. We'll continue to use the chat. Our preliminary research found several opportunities in Edmonston, revitalization of older properties, which fits with that industrial discussion we were just having, diversifying industrial space, again, moving it on to maker space or incubator space for other types of businesses. Edmonston is close to some vibrant growing areas, for example, Hyattsville, and not too far from several other communities that are growing. And then the proposed neighborhood activity center zoning at the northern edge also provides multiple opportunities because it's supposed to build off transit and give mixed use options. So those are just some initial thoughts we had, and love to hear from you.
I know one thing that had come through earlier as an opportunity was trying to bring in some larger stores, some larger retail. And that might be a chain, thinking what can be sustained economically. You know, chains are certainly can be a little bit more viable. And one person even mentioned a grocery store. You know, having to drive for your basic necessities can be tough sometimes. And considering how walkable Edmonston is, I think it could probably, I would think, well supported if there was, you know, a grocery store within walking distance from residents.
I know I've heard more restaurants mentioned a few times too.
So you can always have more restaurants, and that's, you know, La Fondita has a great reputation as having wonderful food, and there's some opportunity in that area. Again, something that we might look at is I think it's kind of Decatur and maybe 47th there at that corner. We've got the IE zone coming in, and that allows for that mix of uses, you know, pretty diverse businesses there. So, you know, just a couple blocks from La Fondita, if we could get some more businesses in there, start to developing that town center, a node where people can go and you don't have to go far for other things in the area. So that's, I think, a really good opportunity for Edmonston that we'll be looking into.
I think another thing that they could consider, since the Purple Line is not going to be too far from Edmonston, this would provide more opportunity to bring businesses along the Kenilworth Avenue, along that corridor. Because that's going to be even more busier because of what's happening with the Purple Line, even though it's further down. So there's opportunity there. And also they should think about the Portsdown plan, the sector plan. That plan is going to be initiated probably in 2024. Think about opportunities from the previous plan that we can move forward. So really give us some thought. Think about that. Community center, there you go. We got it going.
I see a comment that a community center would be great. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, thinking about, you know, places where people can gather, helping build that identity, build community. Going off what Sam said, thinking about the Purple Line, there's a lot of opportunities there, but also what do we do to foster and support those opportunities? Well, we say, oh, the Purple Line can bring in new businesses because it's close proximity, but how do we get to those businesses? So improving wayfinding, improving our pedestrian environment, having a great sidewalk and linkages from Edmonston to the Purple Line, that's how we get there. We've just got to work on connecting those dots.
That's a great thought, Zach. That's a great thought.
That's great. So our final segment of this particular activity is to define some threats. What are some problems that are going to really require a lot of thinking to solve? Threats can be internal or external, but they have the potential to harm the community and jeopardize its success unless we're very keen on paying attention to them and coming up with solutions. So some of the initial things that we found, which we've probably have talked a lot about previously, is physical and geographic separation from neighboring communities. Limited opportunities for population growth since the town is pretty much built out unless some redevelopment occurs. Lagging employment growth, the appearance of industrial and commercial tenants might discourage some desirable businesses from coming in because their perception of Edmonston is not necessarily correct from the outside. And then there's a certain homogeneity of the businesses there. There's a lot of auto-related uses. There's not a lot of diversity in the kinds of businesses you have available to you in the town. So those are the initial threats that the consultant team has come up with. So are we on target? Do you have more? Are some of these not as important as others?
Yeah, there's a lot of overlap or could be with weaknesses here. So it's again, just trying to think a little bit differently about that. And also, you know, remembering the reason it is helpful to identify threats is because behind every threat, there's an opportunity. We can kind of flip these, and for each one, we can find a creative solution to make Edmonston that much better. So while I was thinking, well, what's the use of pointing out the bad things? Well, that's how we improve. So, you know, your feedback here is really crucial and is certainly going to inform our next steps in the strategy as a whole and the vision for the town.
I guess we did a good job on defining the threats and discussing them earlier.
Yeah, and just remember, if there's anything anyone thinks of after this meeting, again, we have the opportunity online. We've got our SWOT analysis survey, so you can go right to our website, answer it there. I know we've actually got, we just made it live at about noon today. We've already got two people who filled out the survey, so that's great. So keep in mind, it's open for 2 weeks. Again, if anything pops into your head, any feedback is good feedback, so we really appreciate that.
Well, I'm glad to hear people are already writing things down. That's terrific. All right, Zach, shall we move on to the visioning portion?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for all those comments you've made. Those are really helpful, and they're going to help us come up with some economic development strategies. But before we do that, the next step is really creating a vision statement for the town of Edmonston and its economic development program. A vision statement, as kind of a reminder, is generally fairly short, very clear, very specific, compelling, timely, describes a clear and present need, and also is reasonable and attainable. So we have to have reasonable expectations of what we can accomplish. You know, Edmonston is not going to be the next space flight center or, you know, whatever great big idea. We're looking for things that are reachable in the next 5 years, 10 years and longer term. So that's kind of the parameters around it. Your input will help us tailor and refine the vision and goals so they reflect the current and future Edmonston economy. Our goal for this activity is for everybody to be creative, but understand that budget and resource constraints do exist. What we're going to do is look at a set of vision statements and get your input on refining those. We're going to use a tool called a vision board, which we're getting to now, I think. Some of the things we'll be talking about is creating collaboration between residents, business owners, and government, prioritizing areas for improvement, supporting businesses, entrepreneurs, and employees, creating an identity for the town, and enhancing livability. So all of those topics are going to come up in the vision boards. And Karen is going to flash that up for us momentarily. Okay. So just to explain briefly what this is, on the left, there are four vision statements. They're color-coded yellow, orange, blue, and green. We're going to try to see if you agree with those and refine them if you don't agree. And on the right, we're going to be setting some priorities for a few business areas. So if we could focus in on the first vision statement that's in yellow, we'll make it a little bit bigger so it's easier to read. All right. Edmonston promotes a healthy, diversified economy, supports local businesses and entrepreneurship, and fosters an environment that helps businesses thrive. The town partners with county government, schools, and nonprofits to achieve its economic development objectives and offers access to a variety of training and professional development opportunities for its residents. This basically means we're encouraging different types of businesses, including startups. There's a varied economy, strong businesses. The government partners with other entities who can supplement its resources. Those are the basic thoughts behind that statement. We'd like to know if you agree with this vision, or if you don't agree with it, what would you change about it? And please use the chat again.
Yeah, and you can also raise your hand. We've got the hand raising function. So if you'd like to come off mute and tell us what you think, and we can have a little dialogue here. And again, what we're really trying to hear is, you know, there's a lot of pieces of this vision statement: a diverse economy, local businesses, you know, professional development. So do you like this vision statement overall? Maybe you can give us a little thumbs up in the chat. Is there a specific piece that you like? Maybe you really just like the professional development part, or maybe you don't. Is there anything that you don't like about this? And then there's things that we can also change.
I see a raised hand from Rosa.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So, you know, as a town resident, and I've been here for 6 years, I would strongly support a stronger schools in the neighborhood. Certainly, this is a very diverse neighborhood. However, the closest I have a 6-year-old, so I used Riverdale Elementary School as an example. The school isn't very diverse. So we can tell that there's a lot of young families with young children, but there's a reason why they don't send their kids to those schools. And I think that schools can be something that can be improved. If it isn't building a school specifically here in this neighborhood, maybe just, you know, partnering with the schools nearby to improve, you know, a system and make them a little more diverse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's good. And schools, I mean, talking about economic development, it really starts with schools and having a good education. You know, we train and we develop our new workforce. And so we need people who have those skills that we need. And partnerships with schools are a fantastic way to do that. So professional development opportunities, you know, getting our kids prepared, whether it's for college or the trades, is really something that can be focused on. So that's helpful. Schools can always be improved.
Thank you for that. Are there any other comments about this first vision of a more diversified economy and partnerships?
Yeah, and just one more reminder, again, the vision board will be online afterwards. So you'll be able to go in and leave little sticky notes with comments yourself afterwards as well.
Okay, let's move on to vision number 2, which is in a very different direction. Edmonston continues to develop in an ecologically sustainable way, capitalizing on its natural assets, parks and pedestrian bicycle trails, and promoting eco-friendly enterprises, renewable technologies, green buildings, and infrastructure. So first, do you agree with this? And second, how important is it? Is this a major value held by the town and its residents? Or is it secondary to other things? Does it need to be changed, enhanced? What more can we say about ecological sustainability in the town?
And I think this is something, again, that we can really leverage. There's already a lot of assets in terms of, you know, the physical environment itself, but also the businesses, the mindset of the residents in Edmonston. You know, it's already starting to develop an identity as a sustainable community. It has the sustainable community designation through the state DHCD, Department of Housing and Community Development. So there's already this suite of grants and financial funding options that are available to the town. So if this is something that's important, let us know. We can continue to build that and use that as a way to guide, you know, the vision for the town and economic development moving forward.
I don't see any comments in the chat.
Yep, and that's all right. You know, we understand that community meetings can be a little daunting for some, but again, we want to make this interactive. So any feedback you have, you know, is great. You know, engagement is key here because we want the vision to reflect you.
I'm going to take the relative silence as approval of vision number two.
You know, who doesn't like sustainability? I think it's a pretty popular concept. So
right. So let's look at number three. This deals more with quality of life for residents. Edmonston is recognized for its quality of life, diverse employment and housing opportunities, safety, and respect for the diversity of its people. The town's creative and energetic government focuses on creating economic benefits for its constituents. So here we're saying this is a great place to live, and you feel that the government is helping you attain those quality of life objectives. Do you agree with that? And is that an important objective for the future?
And this is something I know as a non-Edmonton resident, you know, applied for this program. It was Rod, your town administrator, and he really pulls out all the stops and, you know, making change happen wherever he can. You know, I know there's been facade improvements. The town has received a number of grants throughout the last few years, you know, with the hard work of Rod. And then also government that goes door to door and gives you a little postcard notifying you of this meeting. That's really special. And if there's something specific you want your government to do, you've got people who are motivated. So, you know, tell us now, what are those things? What can your government do for you? You know, you've got a diverse housing stock, and you have a diverse population. You know, what can we build on? What do we need more of in the town? So again, feel free to raise your hand and come off mute. You can put your feedback in the chat.
I'm just going to repeat here again that community center, you know, a vote for that. I think just having a place, not just the playgrounds, but a place where the community can come together. I don't know about you guys, but a pool would be nice, a community pool.
yeah, certainly. So I know, Rosa, let me ask, I know you've got a rec center in the town, right? How is that used by residents, or how could we improve that space?
You know, I can say I've certainly used it. I think that the town also, you know, pre-COVID has done very well by keeping the community engaged. I think that we can certainly do better with programs to, you know, just do a little more outreach to the Spanish-speaking community and, mm-hmm. You know, the elderly as well. I think that one of the things that we loved about this town is that, you know, housing is very, is still affordable. Mm-hmm. In the diversity here. So I think just maybe creating larger spaces for, you know, that it's accessible to people of all ages. Right now, I think it's, you know, it's a very small center. There isn't much that you can do in terms of group gatherings and workshops or anything like that. But I think that improving that space so that, you know, we can get the community engaged would be great.
Yeah, so okay. I mean, some more flexible community space, maybe some more amenities within it that allows for a more, you know, a broader range of people to really use it.
Yes, I mean, I know Heightsville will be reopening the library soon, but there, you know, we have, if you don't have a vehicle, but I think most residents, so you have to drive to the library to, you know, but as far as community centers, the closest one that is, I think, decently sized, and I would say it's in Greenbelt.
Oh, wow.
Maybe Landover area. So it's pretty far. The community center in the Heightsville area, it's not, I was just there last week, and it's, you know, I think we could do better.
That's really helpful. And community centers not only serve residents, but they serve the businesses. If we have, you know, some sort of, you know, open houses or, you know, business like a business fair, you know, what better place than convening around the community center as a way to promote Edmonston. So that'd be good. I also see one in the chat from a little earlier, but I think this is relevant here. A co-op would be nice. So again, maybe we can advocate for a co-op talking about grocery stores, you know, having your food accessible is, you know, is really a key asset for many. So I think that's helpful there as well.
Excellent. Well, let's move on to number four, our final vision statement. And this relates more to the commercial buildings in town, which we've already discussed to some extent earlier. So we may not have a whole lot new to say here, but our vision is that commercial buildings in Edmonston have varied uses, which could be industrial or retail or restaurant, entertainment or office space. These buildings are well maintained and provide a variety of jobs for residents, as well as attracting larger region serving employers. I think that this already reflects what people were saying earlier in the meeting, but let's confirm that people agree with this, or if not, how would you make it elaborate on these points or change them?
Yeah, and those industrial properties will certainly be a focal point of this. And I think it's just, you know, how can we improve what is? I think many are, you know, a little too soon to think about how we should just get rid of and replace. But those businesses, while, you know, they may aesthetically not be what people are hoping for, they serve a very important role in the economy. And, you know, that's one of those foundational pieces of Edmonston. So we need to build from that, always thinking about this improvement mindset. And so, you know, facades is one, kind of the street environment around these could be another. So if there's anything else, you know, what specifically about some of these areas do you think that we should improve?
I know in an earlier meeting, people had brought up landscaping or, you know, making the street itself more walkable, more pleasant to be on. I know that the town has tried very hard to improve Decatur Street, but maybe some of the other streets could use some improvements as well. With better sidewalks, some plants, some benches, as you mentioned, the directional signage, wayfinding. And then maybe on some of these industrial buildings are not so attractive, maybe better lighting or catchy murals, you know, small visual improvements.
And that's a key part of placemaking, which is, you know, somewhat a planning based term, but is placemaking is how do you create place? How do you create that identity? How do you know that you are somewhere? So it's not, you know, it's no longer you drive past the old industrial building. It's the industrial building with that great mural on it. And all of a sudden people know where Edmonston is. So there's a lot of creative options here. It's not just about, you know, fixing it up. It could be something as much as, you know, putting a mural on it, and that can speak to, you know, the diversity of Edmonston. It can speak to the history of Edmonston. It can do a lot more than a coat of paint could otherwise.
Right. We covered a lot of ground with these four vision statements, but just in case we missed something, we'd like to give you the opportunity to bring up anything that hasn't been brought up yet. So this is kind of that big empty box at the bottom. What have we missed, and what would you like to bring up we haven't talked about yet, if anything?
See in the chat, we've got sidewalks on Lafayette Street. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and certainly Lafayette Street, I would imagine, you know, for Edmonston future is going to be a place where more businesses are going to locate. And, you know, ideally those would be serving the residents of Edmonston. So enhancing the public realm would make that even more attractive and more likely that people are going to go there and support those businesses. So that's great.
Mm-hmm. Very good. All right, we're going to move on to the final exercise, which actually will probably go fairly quickly. We're going to try to set some priorities on some of the areas we've talked about. So we have five areas that we want to focus in on a little bit and get your thoughts. The first one is diversifying business uses. What kinds of businesses do you want to see in Edmonston? and where should they be located? So we've heard grocery, we've heard co-op, we've heard some art-related businesses. What else are priority businesses that we should go after?
Yeah, so raise your hand and you can come off mute, let us know in the chat. Again, this is a great opportunity. You know, what do you want to see for your community? This is the future here. So, you know, having that input now is a great opportunity. So, you know, really let us know what you want to see. This is your time. And we could always use some more restaurants. You know, La Fondita is great. If we could get a couple more in there, you know, with Edmonton being so walkable, I mean, I would think they'd easily be pretty supported. Hopefully we're getting on the other side of COVID now, so, you know, restaurants feel a little more confident about locating in places. Yeah, we got a few in the chat. Restaurants, medical, that's a good one. You know, there's always a need for, you know, for a first aid place, you know, or even more holistic medicines. We've got grocery stores, cafes. Again, it doesn't have to be a full-blown restaurant. I was even thinking getting some food carts. If we can get some food carts along the river, something that's somewhat temporary, but we know that people love the river, people from outside of Edmonton riding their bike, maybe a couple food carts along the river would do a lot of good also.
Those are always popular. That's mm-hmm. a big draw. Coffee shop. Yes.
Yeah, food truck near the river. Exactly.
Where would, so we talked about the river. Where would some of these other businesses go? Are we thinking in the industrial parks in the north or the south or Lafayette Street? Is there a particular location that makes sense for some of these? Like, where would you put a medical use? Where would you put an arts-related use? Yeah, and Richard is saying, what kind of businesses would you like to see in the north and south industrial areas?
Yeah, and this is also, you know, gearing towards the employees of that area or to the business owners or even the customers. If you're going to get your car worked on, what would be great around the corner where you could hang out for 30 minutes while you get an oil change?
I think that's the coffee shop or the sandwich shop, right?
Mm-hmm. So yeah, we've got Lafayette because of the parking, the accessibility, you know, that's great. Okay. Again, right in that northern industrial area there.
Mm-hmm. And that's really where we have the most potential for change in the north, I think, because of the new zoning.
Mm-hmm. All right, this is good though. I think we're getting a little more engagement here. This is encouraging. Maybe we can move on to our next one.
Next one, well, that kind of overlaps with the first one because we were talking mm-hmm. about businesses in general, but it always boils down to retail and restaurant anyway, developing additional retail and restaurant space. So let's talk a little bit about restaurants. What does that mean? Does that mean something like a sandwich shop? Does it mean something like a Denny's or a Ruby Tuesdays? Or is it a white tablecloth restaurant, which is a little bit higher end? You know, what would be great to have in Edmonston?
Yeah, that can also be, you know, retail too. It could be, you know, a clothing shop. You know, we talked about grocery stores. You know, maybe it's, you know, we'd like a, you know, a Central American food store. Maybe we'd like an African food store. So there's a lot of options that we could go here. And it's really just, you know, what are the residents going to support? What do you want to see? Yeah, so we've got the sandwich shop, coffee shop. Those are both good. Casual dining, yes. It seems like, again, this is a more affordable neighborhood. You have a lot of working class folks. So having dining options that serve them, you don't necessarily always want to be attracting people from outside of town, but how do we support those people? So some casual dining options would be great for that.
Mm-hmm. Do people have any objection to chains, or are those okay? You know, sometimes people like, you know, a mom and pop operation, kind of homegrown, but sometimes it's easier for a chain to come in because you know what to expect and you know what they have. And, you know, depends on the, I'm kind of curious about the local preference there.
Yeah. And the chains can also take a little bit more risk financially, especially in, you know, uncertain times as these.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll try to explore some options and see what might fit.
Yeah.
All right.
It says we have enough chains nearby.
Yep. Okay. Well, that's good to know.
Mom and pops, beggars can't be choosers. Yep. Restaurants are restaurants to a point, I guess. But again, if we can kind of preference, you know, some more locally owned businesses, that's always good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. We got some agreement there.
Let's see. Let's move on to the next area then, which relates to the physical condition of the commercial properties. What would you want the town's commercial and industrial properties to look like? How do they need to change? We touched on that a little bit earlier, too. We talked about murals and lighting and kind of generally cleaning up the exterior appearance. But are there any specifics of the physical condition that worry you and that you have a fix for or an idea for how they could be fixed?
And this could come in a lot of form. It's, you know, both aesthetics, it's, you know, the general maintenance level, like how do they function? And it could also be things like, you know, the environmental sustainability of a building. We've got this new green area requirement for, I believe it's the, is it the IE zone as the new green area requirement? So they're gonna have to set aside some green space. And that does a lot of things, you know, thinking about climate change, stormwater. So, you know, if we can treat stormwater on site, you've got the river nearby, so that's always a benefit. So is there anything specific about these industrial properties that you think could enhance them or make them more attractive from either a business owner standpoint or as residents? Yeah, I see we've got Rosa with a hand up again.
Hey, so I think that making facade improvements to the businesses on 46th Avenue would be, being that I'm on this side of the river, would be a huge improvement. You know, it's just being so close to the playground there, but also, you know, from visitors who are coming to Edmonston, if you're coming down Decatur, that is the first thing that you see to your left. So I think that improving those facades, you know, would make a great impression.
Great. And that's one of those things where we want to leave that good impression. It's about creating an identity, branding yourself as a place. So yeah, that's a great point. Mm-hmm. Great location.
Excellent. All right, let's move on to increased connectivity with adjacent communities. What do you leave town to go see or do or to shop? And is it hard for you to get there? Do you have to use your car to get there? If you were to imagine yourself 3 years from now in an improved Edmonston, how would you get to those places? Are you interested in walking more or using transit more or staying with your car? What would make sense to make your life easier as you go to various opportunities in other communities?
Yeah, I think this would be a good place to put that comment that we saw earlier would be a bus stop on Decatur Street. You know, if that's, you know, we probably call that the main street. You know, we've got Kenilworth Ave, that's kind of more of a thoroughfare, but mm-hmm. we're thinking that nice pedestrian environment. You know, if we could get a bus stop on Decatur Street, I think that would do a lot. And talking about supporting future businesses, existing businesses, that's a great way to do that.
Do people like to go to Hyattsville or College Park or Bladensburg or other communities, Riverdale Park? Where do you go when you're not in Edmonston and you're not going to your job?
Yeah, Rosa?
So I have to admit, when I'm working from home and I'm able to leave work early, I love to walk down to the Riverdale Town Center or to the district, you know, to Franklin's, to enjoy a good drink, especially in the summertime. But for example, I realized that there isn't, or I would personally love to see a connection between Lafayette to that Riverdale Town Center, rather than walking all the way around via Taylor Street. Just connecting the two communities would be great. And also, I know we mentioned this earlier, but maybe creating a pedestrian walkway over the train tracks, just to make it safer for the community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, certainly. How do you feel about traveling by bicycle? Do you think, is that something that, you know, people do in the community, or is it usually by foot and by car?
I know I see a lot of, people using the bike trucks. I think that one of the biggest points that, you know, brought us to this community were the trails, and how you can go from Greenbelt all the way to the National Harbor if you're physically able to. So I think that people certainly do make use of them, and that is one of the things that we enjoy a lot about the neighborhood.
Okay, so yeah, building off existing connections, creating more. Yeah, that's good.
Excellent. And then we'll wind up with discussion of eco-friendly activities. As we mentioned earlier, that you have several eco-friendly businesses in town, and it's also a sustainable community. Are there additional eco-friendly activities or businesses that would fit with what you already have, and that would sort of give a critical mass that the town would become more known for being green and eco-friendly, and maybe that would be a way to attract more people to town or to provide more support for existing businesses? You know, what fits with the few that you already have that would amplify on that theme?
Yeah, I'm talking about community forklift, Eco City Farm, again, things like that. And this is also, we can think outside of the box. I mean, just because you don't see one of these businesses in your area doesn't mean that we can't create it. A composting program. Yes, that would be a really good one.
Yes.
Yeah, and especially, you know, I think about environmental education. Composting can make money, but it can also be a fantastic educational opportunity. Kind of instilling these values on the next generation is key for creating, you know, sustainability into the future.
Where is the nearest composting station? I wonder. I don't actually know.
Yeah, I don't know.
Is there a pickup point at a farmer's market, maybe?
You know, they do have, they initiated a program in the county where you actually could, I guess you could submit an application and they'll send a container that you can put your composite materials in and they'll pick it up. But it's a program that they just started with the county. I can't remember the name of it though.
Oh, is that where there's a container for each household to do their own? Okay.
Yes.
And then the county will come and pick it up at some certain regular intervals?
Yes, exactly. Okay.
Well, that's a
it
good
recently thought. Started. Can't remember the name of the program, but it was something that was sent out, I would say about, probably was in January when they sent it out.
Oh, super. We'll check into that. Great. Compost crew.
You know, you need people to manage the compost. That's interesting. Curbside pickup for compost is becoming somewhat of a popular thing these days. And believe it or not, when we think about the waste we put in landfills, when we think about sustainability, food waste is 30-40% of what we throw out. So Imagine diverting that from the waste stream, and then you can repurpose it. You know, we supporting local gardens, supporting eco farms, and there's a whole host of things you can do with that. Vermiculture, you can have a worm farm. There's a whole lot of things that you can do with compost, and the environmental benefits are, you know, self-enforcing. So All right.
Well, this is terrific. Thank you all so much for all your suggestions. There's a lot of good thoughts here. You confirm some of our impressions, and then you're giving us new things to work with. So we really appreciate that. So we're going to kind of wrap up. This was the end of the activities, but our team will explain what happens next and how we're going to come back to you in a couple months with some recommendations for the town to proceed on. But at this point, we'll let Zach and Sam explain what happens next on this project.
Mm-hmm. So you can probably move on to our next slide here. And we really just want to, again, open it up for questions. If there's any last questions about our activities, about our existing conditions, our research findings, you know, really let us know. Again, we'll be happy to answer any questions online after the fact. Pretty soon here, we'll have our contact information. Our website's a fantastic way to engage. So if you've got any questions now, let us know. And feel free to raise your hand, come off mute if you do.
There's something in the chat that someone posted about curbside food scrap collection composting.
Okay, yeah, the compost collection. This is good. We'll check this out. Maybe there's a way that we can integrate it into our strategy. And again, I think a lot of this is about getting a critical mass. If you can get 100 people in Edmonston to commit to composting, then it probably lowers the price or makes it more likely for pickup. Or you can even, you know, if you get enough people, you can think about maybe it's not the county's composting program, but we can support a local composting business. So there's a lot of opportunities there. I appreciate that, Link. So if there's no questions, I think we're going to move on to our next steps here.
Zach, I just wanted to mention, I think that Heightsville has a composting program, so maybe something that we could piggyback off.
Okay, great. Yeah, that's very helpful. I don't know if that's run by the town or is that a private thing?
I believe it's run through the town.
Okay, great. Thank you. All right, so after this workshop, again, we're going to make that SWOT analysis survey and the vision board available on our website for 2 weeks for continued feedback from the community. After that, the project team will work to finalize the goals and the vision statements for the town that we came up with today and will continue to work on. We'll then hold a consensus building workshop. That's going to be with the mayor and the town council to help prioritize economic development goals and integrate the vision into the town's future work. Following the town council's adoption of the vision and specific goals, we'll then prepare a series of economic development recommendations that will feed into the final strategy. And then we'll hold a final community meeting again in late spring or early summer to present the draft economic development strategy. So please, again, make sure to stay tuned, follow us on our website, shoot us an email. As a reminder, we'll have the recording of this meeting and all the meeting materials, including the PowerPoint online afterwards in the next few days. And then you can contact us, the project team, by email with any questions you have about the project or the workshop. Feel free to reach out to Sam, our project manager, or myself with any questions that you might have, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. We're pretty responsive, so please reach out. And with that, we really just want to thank you. We appreciate your participation, your commitment to Edmonston, and really we couldn't do any of this without you and your fantastic feedback. So thanks for participating. We couldn't do it without you, and have a wonderful evening. Thank you.